The interesting thing about this archive, of course, is it relates to cinema. And the extraordinary thing about cinema costumes is that they live for such a short period of time. I mean, of course, they are made for the shoot of the film, for the duration, for maybe 2-3 months, maybe 6 months maximum. But they may be on the screen for 3 seconds, or not at all. And that is their life. And even if they are a costume that's worn by a protagonist in the film, who's in many scenes, there are only so many gestures that that garment makes. And when we first met this archive, and it really was like meeting people or meeting animals, actually, it was more like going to the zoo than anything. It was like finding creatures that had been locked up and had more, they wanted to play, and they wanted to make more shapes, different shapes. So when I'm making the shapes that I do, I never make a shape that the piece wears in the actual film in which it features. Very often it's very the opposite, but it's about giving the piece a life, a new life. And then of course they will get put back again in their paper and until we do it again. The question of preparation is easy because in many ways I don't prepare at all. I don't even prepare for each performance. Each performance is to a certain extent choreographed, but to a certain extent very free and improvised.
A few years ago, I met Clara Pomphili, who is a very important person into the project. I met her in Firenze, in Italy, and I asked to her, where could I discover the costume of Pasolini? And she said to me, very naturally, it's very easy because I am in charge of the archive of Pasolini costume. So we were invited maybe a few months after to discover the costume with Tilda, and we were very flexible, you know. It's doing a performance is the same thing than doing an exhibition.
I found myself looking behind so that they can't hear me discussing my favorite. Like children never have a favorite. But I have a special affection for the green velvet cloak of Geoffrey Chaucer from the Canterbury Tales, which of course is played, is worn by Pierpaolo Pasolini, and the cap.
We were very worried not to repeat some gesture, some movement into the movies, because it's not a biopic. I have to say very honestly, I was interested to see how Tilda could wear them, could embody them, and also how impossible it was sometimes to go inside the costume or to give a new life into the costumes, because they are monuments.
I have a very different relationship with the archive from Salo. That's very difficult, genuinely very difficult to find the... Olivier describes these pieces as monuments. They're like relics. I feel that the Salo pieces are like relics, and it's always extremely taxing for me to perform that section. It's a delight to work live, particularly in this slightly choreographed, slightly improvised way. I love to work with the freedom in which we work. We're both authors of this work. That's very important to me too. I don't feel like an interpreter. It's not my natural position to be an interpreter. One of the ways in which we've developed my operation in this world, not only as a co-author, but as a fellow creature who moves amongst the creatures of the things, is that the sort of fantasy is that I'm a sort of wayward curator who gets enchanted occasionally and gets drawn into these relationships. But the idea is that that's what I am. I have this kind of slightly scientific aspect. And I also am a little like a mannequin and a little like a statue, so that when the pieces are placed on me or around me, there's not too much of me to get in the way. We try and keep me blank, if you like. So that there is that fluidity, so that one minute I'm wearing a young girl's dress and the next minute I'm an old man. And I'm an old man because that is an old man's coat. It's actually the coat that's the old man, not me. It's the piece brings the energy with it, and I just follow. And so my task is to remain fluid and listening. And just keep my ears open. Hello. It's the most mysterious thing. This is about cinema, and it's not about clothes as such, it's about costumes. And they are designed by one very particular artist, Danilo Donati. There was a time when we were originally talking about making a piece devoted to Pasolini, when we were thinking about a melange of other costumes from, for example, the Medea is not represented here because the Medea was, the costumes were designed by Piero Tosi. We decided fairly early to concentrate on this collaboration between Paolo Pasolini and Danilo Donati. I mean, good costume in film is a code. It's not really clothes, because in a film you have to work very fast to identify the code of the portrait that you're playing, because you only have whatever 90 minutes or 3 hours these days, but you don't have that long to actually introduce all the choices this particular person might make about what they're going to put on their body. You have to work with a very quick code. And Danilo Donati is working with Supercode, you know, the pink dress that I just put in the middle and it stands up. They're made of cardboard, they're made of carpet. The baubles down the side of that pink dress are like Christmas decorations that are glued on. I mean, these are not clothes, they are costumes. And so even, now I'm coming to Salo, even with Salo, where you could say he's working, Danilo Donati is working with a more naturalistic palette. You're dealing with, you know, dresses from the, silk dresses from the 50s or the 40s. But no, they're not. They're still highly codified. And for anybody who has seen Salo, and I'm sorry if you haven't seen Salo, because it does help if you've seen Salo in particular to understand that section of the piece, I think. Salo is a terrifying piece of work about real horror and the capacity for humans to degrade each other and meet real cruelty on each other. And these costumes seem to hold that energy. I don't know why. Obviously, it does have something to do with the fact that I've seen that film and I remember those images and I know what that black and white dress means. Because I've seen that film several times and it's horrific what energy sort of swirls around that particular piece of clothing.